Suratul Alaq, as you know, the first five ayat of Suratul Alaq is the first ever wahi received by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi. In second hadith, in his book, he has narrated the whole story from Sayyida Aisha radiyallahu ta'ala anha. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told her, Aisha used to go to a cave in the Mount of Nur, Mount of Light, Jabalun Nur, in front of our, yes, so that Jabalun Nur, people used to go there, the cave is there, cave of Hira. Jabalun Nur, the cave was called as the cave of Hira, the cave of Hira. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to stay for a few days in that cave, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because by nature, he was in hate what the people of Makkah were doing. Making partners with Allah, he said, doesn't make sense. Why partners? Yes, to get into retreat and to have mental tranquil, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to go to Hira. Sayyida Khadija radiyallahu ta'ala anha used to make him some food and some water for a few days. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to go there, stays there for a few days, and when the food and stuff is finished, he came back. So he says, once I was there, suddenly a stranger came there. Yes, and he stood right in front of me in the entrance of cave. In the entrance of cave. And he said to me, Iqra, read. Iqra, read. As I told you, a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has never been in a school or a madrasa. He has never been a student. He doesn't know how to write alif even. Yes? Otherwise, if he would have been a qualified man, people would have made a lot of objections. Yes, he's a PhD, that's why he speaks good. But someone who was pasturing the goats and lambs in mountains, never been even for a single day or single hour even somewhere to study or to learn. And suddenly, he speaks in such a way that people got amazing. Oh, the way he speaks. So it means that he has been revealed. He has been revealed. He got inspired by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there is no any room to make any doubt. That's the first ever thing for a messenger of Allah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, Ma ana biqareem. I'm not a literate man. I've never been in a madrasa. I've never been in a school. I cannot read. What should I read? So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Faqattani. He covered me in his laps and he squeezed me. Then he left me and he said, read, iqra. Once again I said, ma ana biqari'in. So for the second time he squeezed me. And then he said, read, iqra. So once again I said, ma ana biqari'in. Faqattani ya salisa hatta balagha minni al juhda. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, he put me in trouble for the third time. Because he squeezed me to my utmost, not to his utmost. Because it was his utmost, that's way too much. When Jibreel squeezed someone, so he destroyed hundreds of thousands of people with one single shout. With what? Huh? With one single shout, he destroyed the whole ummah. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hatta balagha minni la minhu al-juhda. Hatta balagha minni al-juhda. He squeezed me to my utmost, to my capacity. وَخَشِيْتُ عَلَىٰ نَفْسِ. And I had a fear of myself that maybe this guy is going to kill me. This guy is going. And then he released me. And he said, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. How Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم got it and he disappeared. Yes. He recited these five ayat and he disappeared. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got it. Because I told you, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was receiving wahi by brain or by heart? By heart. So that's why he was not forgetting a single word even. He was not forgetting. Sanukrivuka fala tansa. He never forgot a single word of Holy Quran in 23 years. Because he was getting it by what? By heart. We need someone to stand behind us to give us fatha. To give us what? In Taraweeh, to give us fatha. But Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was never in need of any fatha because he got it by heart. Got it? So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, I came home, but I was shivering. I was? And I was feeling cold because of fear. So when I came, I said to my wife, Khadija, radiyallahu ta'ala anha, zammiluni, zammiluni, cover me in a blanket. Yes. So she brought me a blanket. She covered me. But then she said to me, she was a lady. She was a lady, experienced lady, an intellectual lady. Yes, because when she married Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, her age was 40 years and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was only 25. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam received wahi, his age was 40. So now the age of Khadija was 55. Yes, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam married her, she was a widow of two husbands. And from both of them she had kids. So she was an experienced lady, number two. Number three, that she was a very rich lady, having a very extended type of merchandise and business. So she was an intellectual lady, experienced lady. She said to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she said, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is not a case of malaria. This is not a case of fever. This is not a case of fever. Ya subhanallah, what a laboratory she was. She did not have any laboratory. Yes, her approach was just like a laboratory. Otherwise, we would have taken him to Kaiser. Let's go. What's going on? Yes, some type of flu or what? But Sayyida Khadija, radiyallahu ta'ala anha, she said, this is not a case of fever. This is not a case of malaria. This is not a disease. This is not a sickness. Tell me what happened to you. This is fear. This is what? This fear. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam related the story to Khadija. And he said that, Khadija, I don't want to go back to that cave again. Got it? Khadija was a lady. She said, La, no. Don't think like this. La, no. Wallah, I swear by Allah. La yukhzik Allah abada. Allah will never put you down. Why you are afraid of? Nothing will happen to you. Yes, because of your noble character. Because of your noble. So it means that was the time of Jahiliyyah, the time of ignorance. But still, character was character. Character was appreciated. Character was welcomed. Character was respected. And that was their faith. A man of character would never be humiliated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Got it? So if you will try to be on a high level of character, inshallah your life will be easy. Your life will be easy. And if you are flip-flop, so nobody will give you respect. Yes or not? That you can switch him either way. Yes. And if you will show yourself, then nobody can switch me. I am strict to my guns. Yes. So it means that you have character. You have high level of character. Got it or not it? Got it? Yes. And how you will get into? When you will say bye-bye to greed and to miserliness. Never be greedy, nor be miser. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put you on a high moral level. Got it? So Sayyida Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha mentioned the five things which was the known practices of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a perfect human being before message even. Number one, innaka latasilur rahim. You are taking care of your kith and kin. Whosoever was related to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even a very far relation, far kindred, and he was in trouble, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to rush to and to help him out. He is related to us. How? He is our 21st cousin, not second or third cousin. He is our what? 21st cousin. Yes, we get connected to each other and level 21st or 21. So he was taking care of his far kindred. إِنَّكَ لَتَصِلُ الرَّحِيمِ. Number two, وَتَحْبِلُ الْكَلْ. Somebody who is burdened, his life is burdened for himself. So Prophet ﷺ used to take his responsibility. Somebody who was thinking of suicide. Who was thinking of what? Of suicide. Because his life became a burden on his shoulder. He is trying to get rid of his life even. Prophet ﷺ used to help him, to give him courage to live. To give him courage to live. Yes. What's wrong with you? What's going on? Oh, I have that many loans and I am unable to pay it. And yes, even though they were not getting any loan from banks or things like that. But whatever loan they had, Prophet ﷺ said, okay, don't worry. I will take care of your loans. Yes. Yes, but try to live. Live like a human. Yes, be a strong man.
Why you are that much weak?
And number three, وَتُقْسِبُ الْمَعْدُونَ. You are looking jobs for jobless people. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, somebody came to him that I don't have any job. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to ask people, anybody who can arrange a job for one brother, two brothers, three brothers, or as the case may be. Number four, وَتَقْرَ الزَّيْفِ. You give a due respect to the guest, because guest is respected. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيُكْرِمْ زَيْفَهُ. Whosoever believe in Allah and in the day of judgment, he must give a due respect to his guest. Somebody who is not giving respect to his guest, so he is no man. Yes. In cultured people, he is no man. فَلْيُكْرِمْ زَيْفَ. He must give a due respect to his guest. That's number four. And number five, وَتُعِينُ عَلَىٰ نَوَائِبِ الْحَقِّ. You are standing on the side of someone who has the right stand. Doesn't matter, he's a stranger or he is known to you. But you are with someone who has a right stand. So, and if you will look into these five characters, yes, it will make a human a perfect one. It will make a human being a perfect one. So, Sayyidah Khadija, radiallahu ta'ala anha, was putting in his mind, you are a perfect human. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put you down? He will never put you down. Yes, because you don't have any shortfall and shortcomings. So don't worry. And let me take you to my cousin, Warika ibn Nawfal. Warika ibn Nawfal. Wakana imran tanassara fil jahiliya. Imam Bukhari says, Wakana imran tanassara fil jahiliya. He was a man who accepted Christianity in the time of jahiliya, because he was not worshipping idols. He was not worshipping. So at that time, Christianity was there in that area. So he accepted that this is a revealed religion. We should follow this, not a self-created religion of idol worship. Yes, and he was a scholar of Torah and Injil. Torah and Injil. In such like situation, people do approach the ulama. People do approach the ulama. So Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha said, let me take you to Warika ibn Nawfal, to my cousin. So she took him and she said to Warika, at that time he was a blind man, very old man and blind. Yes, his sight was gone. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he went there and he said, Masa an-Nur. Because at that time, Salaamu Alaikum was not there. Greeting was, Masa an-Nur, good evening, or good afternoon. Yes, so Warika ibn Nawfal said, Khadija? She said, yes. Haza Muhammad? Is your husband? She said, yes. Something happened to him. Isma'hu, aw istami' lahu. Listen to him very carefully. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam related a story. So Warika ibn Nawfal, he said, oh, my nephew, don't worry. Don't. Nothing will happen to you. Yes. Hazan Namus, Allazi Ja ila Musa alayhi salatu wa salam. This is the archangel who used to come to Prophet Musa. This was the angel, yes, who used to come to Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wa salam. Anyhow, Muhaddisin says that he himself was a Christian. Why he did not mention Isa? So they mentioned the point because Isa alayhi salatu wa salam never fought in his lifetime. There was no practical jihad. He will do it when he will come back. And he will do it in, yes, 100% correct and accurately. Got it or not it? Yes, but in his first coming, he never fought against any nation or any tribe or any people. You know, no jihad took place in the time of Isa alayhi salam. But Musa alayhi salatu wa salam, his day and night was in jihad with that stupid guy. Yes, and his government. Yes, he was not a common layman. He was what? A ruler. And a very rough type of ruler. Yes, as he said to Musa alayhi salatu wa salam, Inni la zunnuka ya Musa mashura. I think that you are bewitched. You got mesmerized by someone. You are demonized. You are what? Demonized. So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was not a man to keep quiet in front of that guy who had hundreds of thousands of army standing there. And Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was alone with his brother Harun alayhi salatu wasalam. Yeah. So as we say in Urdu language, eend ka jawab patthar se dena. That he hit him with a brick. With what? With a brick. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam hit him with a rock. Yes. He said, Inni la zunnuka ya Musa mashura. You got demonized. So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam said, wa inni la zunnuka ya fir'aun masbura. Yes, but I am very much sure that you got destroyed. You are gone. You know what I'm saying? You got destroyed. You are gone. So Pharaoh, he was looking here and there at what he means. He's blasting himself or what? He has the jacket or the belt. You know what I'm saying? Got it? Yes. So now Pharaoh, he came to know that something is going on. Let me be careful. So as the life of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was full of these type of things, so Warqa ibn Nawfal, by saying so, because the resemblance of the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam in Torah and Injil is like the message of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. Difficulties, hardship, fighting the rulers, challenging them. And Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he challenged only one ruler. He challenged only. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, in his lifetime, he was challenging tens of rulers. Yes, Kisra was on one hand, Kaiser was on the other hand, other kings and rulers, they were on the other hand. In 1 year, he challenged 11 of them. In 1 year, he challenged 11 of them with one single word, Aslim Taslam. He wrote letter in the name of every single ruler. And what was the wording? Aslim Taslam. If you are looking for security, accept my message. Yes. If you are looking for security and you are protecting your life, so what you do? That is way too much. It is easy. Say, that is easy. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam challenged 11 people at once. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was taken by Khadija radiyallahu ta'ala anha to her cousin, namely Warqa ibn Nawfal. وَكَانَ إِمْرَأً تَنَصَّرَ فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. Imam Bukhari narrates that he was a man who accepted Christianity in the time of ignorance. And then he became an authentic authority in Old and New Testament both. And people used to approach him to seek his advice regarding certain things. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam related his story, so Warqa ibn Nawfal told him, يَبْنَ أَخِي, O my nephew, هَذَا النَّامُوسَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ عَلَى مُوسَى عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. That is the namus. There are two words in Arabic. One is called namus and the other one is called jasus. So jasus is a spy. Yes. Someone who is taking your secrets to others to harm you. He is called jasus. And namus is someone who is keeping your secrets. So namus is trustworthy. Yes, if he is from human, so he is a man. Yes, and Jasus is no man. So, and yes? Yes, got it. So he said that this is the Namus, the secret keeper, used to come to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. So as you know, that he was a Christian, he was supposed to mention Isa, but he didn't. He mentioned Musa, because the Christians, they believe in Musa. The Jew do not believe in Isa. So he was a Christian. So he did believe in Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. Number one. Number two. Regarding the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, in Old and New Testament, it has been mentioned that his mission will be very much similar to the mission of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. And the mission of Musa was to challenge the people in authority. To challenge the people in, and not only people are dictators. People in authority, who are dictators, or you can say aristocratic government, aristocratic governments. So Pharaoh, he was an aristocrat, a mean ruler. Got it? And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he challenged aristocratic rulers, not only one. Tens of them, not only one, tens of them. Got it? And then Warqa ibn Nawfal said that, oh my nephew, I think I will not be able to join you because I am an old man. But if I am still there, I want to join you when the people will turn you out or drive you out of Makkah and you will be going to Ardhun Nakhla. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he became alert with this prophecy. And he said, oh, Abu Mukhrijiyahum, people will drive me out of my own hometown. Said, yes, that's mentioned in Old and New Testament both. They will drive you out. So I want to join you. I want to be the lucky man accompanying you. But that lucky man was Abu Bakr radiyallahu ta'ala an. So anyhow, then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, when I came back, so sometime I was thinking to tell people that I received a message. And an angel of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he approached me. But then I was thinking, maybe people will think that he's crazy. Yes, he lost his brain. So that's why I kept quiet. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, on one hand, I was thinking of that messenger and his message. Yes, and I wished to have him once again. But on the other hand, the way he squeezed me, I was very much afraid of. Yes, so these developments were taking place in my brain. And sometime I was unable to control myself. And I used to think to commit suicide. That was the situation Prophet ﷺ was passing through. Yes, and he said that a few times I tried to go to Abu Qubais and to throw myself down there from. Yes, but the moment I started climbing to Abu Qubais mountain, yes, so the same angels, without having any visible shape, he used to call on me, Ya Muhammad, innaka la Rasulullah. O Muhammad, you are the messenger of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I used to turn around. It was going on for 6 months or for more than that. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, after 6 months, once again, I was coming back to Mecca from the cave of Hira. When I was coming down of Jabal al-Nur, Professor, remember? Nizar Ahmad, you remember? Jabal al-Nur. Yes, Fahim, do you?
Yes.
And Mirza sir, huh? So when I was coming down from Jabal al-Nur, yes, so, Fanuditu min as-sama, from the space, I was called, Ya Muhammad. So when I looked, so I saw the same angel, Jalisin ala kursiyin bayna as-samai wal-arz. He was sitting on a chair in the space in between the heaven and the earth. When I saw him, so I recalled my mind, if he will come this time, he's going to kill me. The way he squeezed me 3 times before. Yes. And the same thing happened to me as it happened to me 6 months before. So I rushed to my house and the same shivering. Yes. And I said to Sayyida Khadija, radiyallahu ta'ala anha, Zammiluni, cover me in a blanket. Yes. And she covered me in a blanket. And at the same time, the angel approached me inside my blanket. Yes. So the first ever wahi was the first 5 ayat of Suratul Alaq. And the second wahi, which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received, that was the first 7 ayat of Suratul Muddathir, chapter 74. Got it? Ya ayyuhal muddassiru. You got it? Ya ayyuhal muddassiru, O the one who covered in blanket. That is a blanket which is very thick, made of goat hairs. That is made of goat hairs. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, at that time, he was covering himself with that type of blanket. Yes, so that blanket got such a fame. Yes, that been mentioned for the last 1500 years and would be mentioning until the day of judgment. Ya ayyuhal muddathir. What a blanket that was. Yes. Ya ayyuhal muddathir, O the one who covered in blanket. Who covered in blanket. Qum, stand up. Fa anzir, and warn people. Qum, stand up and warn people. And why? He was not told Fabashir. Give happy news, because Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he has means 2 sides of his message. Number one, happy news to those who believed and a warning to those who did not. But at that time, there was no believer because no message was there. There were only wrongdoings. Yes, so that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, stand up and warn them of the dire consequences of their wrongdoings. Got it? Ya ayyuhal muddathiru, come stand up. Fa'anzir and warn, wa rabbaka fakabbir, and magnify your Lord. Magnify your, because people in peninsula, they are magnifying certain other deities. So what will be your duty? Yes, they were making grades. This is Kabir, this is Akbar, this is Akbarul Kabair. Wa rabbaka fakabbir, and your Lord, you may magnify. So we will magnify only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, that there is only one Kabir and one Akbar, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because as far as greatness is concerned, that is totally in the entity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, so that's why when we explain Allahu Akbar, so we don't say even though Akbar, that is a superlative degree. That's why, or elative adjective. Elative adjective. So Akbar literal meaning is that bigger than, bigger than. So there must be somebody. So it means that someone is in the same field, but he is lower in grade than Allah subhanahu. Is there anyone in that field? Allah is Allah. Nobody is there in that field of Allah subhanahu. So that's why we say Allahu Akbar, Allah is the great. Allah is the great. There is no any other great. The only great is Allah. Wa rabbaka fakabbir, and your Lord, you may magnify. Wa siyabaka fatwahir, and your garments, purify it. Wa siyabaka, and your garments, fatwahir, purify it. So, was the dress of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam dirty? By nature, he was such a neat and clean man. That Sayyidina Anas says, radiyallahu ta'ala an, I have never seen any dirt on the dress of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was very well disciplined, well organized, very neat and clean man. Clean. And that was his case even before receiving message. So this is actually a proverb used by the people of Arabia. By the people of Arabia. There is room always for further improvement. Yes, for further improvement. Always there is room. So Prophet ﷺ himself, his dress was clean and neat. His nature was neat and clean. But now he was given another duty. So that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, there is room for further improvement. Got it? وَسِيَابَكَ فَتْوَهِرْ, and purify your character. Purify your character. And the same word, jama. What? Jama. Dress mean what? Jama. So the same word jama we use for character in our own language as well. Yes, when somebody is doing wrong things and that has become his habits, so we say in Persian language, "E jama fulanast." This is a dress. This character is his dress. So as you have dressed, yes. Got it? Pressed it to your body, same is the character. So we use the word jama or dress for character. وَسِيَابَكَ فَتْوَيْرْ, and purify your character. وَالرُّجَزَ فَاجُرْ, and keep away from rujas. So ridges. Ridges is actually the excrement. What? Ridges is any dirty thing like excrement. And rujas is such a character or such a practice which is as dirty, but not physically. Spiritually, that is as dirty as excrement is physically. That is as dirty spiritually as excrement is physically. As physically excrement is filthy. Yes, so rujas is something which is as filthy as excrement, but spiritually. So here, that filth mean idol worshipping. Idol worshipping. وَالرُّجْزَ فَاجُرْ, and keep away الرُّجْزَ from idol worshipping. Means keep away from idol worshipping. You are not worshipping idols. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Mean, keep away from idol worshipping, means convince the people to keep away therefrom. وَلَا تَمْنُنْ تَسْتَكْسِرْ وَلَا تَمْنُنْ And never do any good to anybody, تَسْتَكْسِرْ That you are asking or expecting for a recompense in abundance. Yes, that's not investment. That is not investment. That you did some good to someone and you invested that. You gave him $10, but later on you will be expecting from him $100. That's investment. No, do it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You give him 10 or 10,000 or 10 million, give it for Allah. وَلَا تَمْنُنْ تَسْتَكْسِرْ وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ And be patient for the sake of your Lord. So actually in these 7 ayat, there was a perfect message given to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that you have to challenge what they are doing. You have to challenge what they are doing. And you have to improve yourself furthermore. Number 2. And number 3, you have to convince them to keep away of idol worshipping. And number 4, this is not an easy task. They will torture you. They will harm you. So you must be patient for the sake of your Lord. Look, the whole message of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is covered in these 7 ayat. So that was the second wahi received by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So anyhow, go back to your sabak. Now the subject of surah, Suratul Alaq, reading, learning and reciting is must for human. Importance of education, importance of knowledge, importance of deen. You can tell people that education is that much important in Islam that the first ever order Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received from Allah, that was Iqra, read. That was what? Iqra, read. That's the importance of what? Knowledge in deen. Got it? But number 2, Iqra, what? So actually the word Iqra is mostly related to Quran. That read what? Quran. And that's the first ever duty. That is what? The first ever duty of every Muslim to read Quran. Yes, but here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not mention the object. He did not mention the object. But he said, Iqra, read. So ulama says that this is a general order, even though it starts with Quran. But Iqra, kullama tastati'u an taqra'ahu. Read whatever you can read. Read whatever you can read. And that is permissible in Islam. Something which is permissible in Islam. Read whatever you can read. And that is permissible in Islam. So now what is haram in Islam as far as knowledge is concerned? Sorcery. And number 2, music. Sorcery. And number 2, music. All other things, you can use it for good and bad both. But there is no use of music for good and there is no use of sorcery for good. Yes, all other things, you can use it. Even, mean the atomic technology, you can use it, yes, to destroy a whole world, and you can use it for energy and all these type of things. Iqra, read whatever you can read, and that is permissible. And that is, as we mentioned in Hadith class, that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, al-ilmu salasatun. Al-ilmu salasatun. Ayatun muhkamatun, aw sunnatun qa'imatun, aw faridatun adilatun, wa ma siwa zalika fahuwa fazlun, aw kama qala alayhi salatu wassalam. That knowledge is of 3 things. Knowledge is of 3 things. Number 1, ayatun muhkamatun, an ayah of Holy Quran. An ayah of Holy. If you studied one ayah with a proper sheikh and you know all about or most about that ayah, that's knowledge. That is what? That's not, as you are studying the tafsir for regarding every single ayah, sometimes we talk for hours about one ayah. Yes? So that's knowledge. Ayatun muhkama. Aw sunnatun qaima, are a proven sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So you study hadith, that is knowledge. You study hadith, that is knowledge. Aw faridatun adila, are something deduced from ayah or from hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So you people study fiqh, that is knowledge. So that is tafsir, hadith and fiqh. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned it. Tafsir, number 2, hadith and fiqh. Yes, and you people have it. Yes, at least you tafsir, hadith, and fiqh, all three. You people have it. Ayatun, al-ilmu salasatun, ayatun muhkama, aw sunnatun qaima, aw faridatun adila. Whatever you are studying, more than that. Yes, science, technology, physics, chemistry, biology, yes, hundreds of things. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Wa ma siwa zalika fahuwa fazlun." Whatever is more than these three things, so one meaning is fahuwa fazlun, that is extra. That is what? That is extra. Extra means that is not the object of life. That is not the object. That is the need of life. That is what? That is the need of life. That's not the object of life. The object of life is Quran, Sunnah, and Fiqh. Got it? Got it or not it? Yes. Yes. Like bathroom in house, that's not the object. That's what?
Need.
That's need. That's need. Bedroom and kitchen, that's what? That's object in house. But as far as the case of bathroom is concerned, that is need. So nobody is buying a house because of a bathroom. Yes, yes, I buy this house because the bathroom is very, so we have to take him to psychiatrist. Yes. That you will be sleeping in the bathroom, brother. What you will do in the bathroom? Yes. Mostly the people, they try to sing inside the bathroom. Yes. So we call them bathroom singer. So what I was referring to, that ayatun muhkama aw sunnatun qaima aw faridatun adila wa ma siwa zalika fa huwa fazlun. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, whatever is more than that is extra. Number one, fazl one mean extra. Another mean, that's an extra virtue. That's an extra virtue. Got it? That first, as a Muslim, you have to study Quran. You have to study hadith. You have to study fiqh. All other forms of knowledge, these are extra virtue. But we have given priority to extras. The purpose, we have left it. We have thrown it behind. We are running behind what?
Extras.
Got it? Then in this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to that human being is basically an animal. But he is such an animal who has fikr. You can write it. He is such an animal who has intellect. Who has what? Intellect. And through that intellect, he can use things for his good in this world and his good in the hereafter. So based on intellect, they have to recognize their Lord. But what's wrong with them? When they have a little, they think of themselves that they are self-sufficient. Should write it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, what's wrong with human being? When they have a little, they think of themselves self-sufficient. What? Self-sufficient. So somebody who has, yes, subhanallah, I think that nowadays if somebody will have 100,000 in cash, so he'll be thinking of himself that I am self-sufficient. Yes or not? Yes. Yes, huh?
Yes,
yes or not?
Yes.
Yes. And nobody is self-sufficient. Only Allah is self-sufficient. Because the same guy, if he has billions even, he is not self-sufficient. Yes. Now, headache will happen to him. Yes, he will not be able to move. He will call 911 to take him in the ambulance. It means that he is not self-sufficient, even though he has $32 billion. Like, yes. Got it? And then Allah make another complaint that what's wrong with these kafirs or disbelievers? Because they were trying to stop Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his followers from prayer. As Abu Jahl did to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was praying there in Baytullah. He came to him, he said, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, stop this business. Otherwise, I will bring that many people against you in the valley of Makkah. You will not be able to speak a single word. Yes, so actually he was threatening Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What he was doing? Threatening Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Allah warned him. He doesn't know that Allah is watching him. He doesn't know that Allah is watching him. And in the end of surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, let him bring people. Let him bring and gather people from peninsula against you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We will send a few angels there. We will send what? A few angels there. Then they will see what will happen to them. Then they will see what will happen to them. That was actually an ibtila and test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he got tortured by the people of Makkah. Otherwise, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not have willed that, nobody was able to harm him. Yes, as it is said, that one guy, Abu Jahl, owed him some money, but he was not paying to him. Because he was a badmash. He was what? You know badmash? Yes, a wicked and villain. He was a villain. So he approached a few chieftains. If you can tell this Sardar Saab, yes, the big chieftain, he is not paying my money. So nobody was able to talk to that badmash. Yes, that he's a strong man, he is not listening to anybody. Yes. And a few of them told him, if you will ask Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he can go to him, he can approach him. Because he approaches him every day for his own dawah. Say, la ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. So he was very frank in this regard to Abu Jahl. Yes. And we cannot speak to him even. You know what I'm saying? When he is sitting, we are calm and quiet. But he speaks to him, yes, very frequently and very frankly. So just go to him. So the guy came and he said, sir, somebody told me that you can ask Abu Jahl to pay me my money, Amr ibn Hisham. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, let's go. Let's go. So he went there. He knocked at the door. Abu Jahl came out. Yes, he said, yes, how you are here? He said, you owe this guy some money? He said, yes. He said, just pay him. Give him his money. He said, okay, I'm bringing. Yes. So he went back and brought his money and gave it to him. And he was. Somebody told him that, what was wrong with you? Nobody is able to speak to you. When Muhammad came to you, you were shivering. He said, yes, that was not only Muhammad. On his head there was a very big she camel, just like the mount of Abu Qubais. And she was opening its mouth. And the moment I saw, I was very much close to my death. And that's why I told him, okay, I'm bringing it. Got it? So that was the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to put Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to test. Putting someone to test, as I told you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, when Allah wants someone to take him close to himself, he put him to difficulties. He puts him to, say, difficulties. With worship for 1,000 years, you cannot go that much close to Allah as through hardship and difficulty you faced and you were patient and stable. You were patient and stable. So you cannot cut that much distance in 1,000 years by your ibadah. Yes, but by that one hardship, you crossed it and you went close 1,000 year distance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Got it? Iqra, read. Bismi Rabbika. So read whatever you can, but in the name of your Lord. Read in the name of your. So something, look at me, which is not allowed, which is not permissible in Islam. Can you start it in the name of Allah? Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes. If somebody will say, let's start music in the name of Allah. Yes, he's putting his iman on stake. Let's start music what? In the name of Allah. Oh, brother, in the name of Allah, anything which is permissible, you can start with. Got it? So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put the condition, Bismi Rabbika, it means that the subject must be a permissible one. Iqra, read, Bismi Rabbika, in the name of your Lord. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say Iqra Bismi Ilahika. Oh, Iqra Bismillah, in the name of Allah, but in the name of your Lord, in the name of your Lord, in the name of your Rabb. Number one, to remind us the Misaqul Azal in Alamul Arwah, in world of spirits, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken a promise of us and we have given a pledge to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we will believe in your Lordship. We will believe in your Lordship. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminded us with first wahi that I'm your Lord. So whatever you are doing, do it in the name of your Lord. Do it in the name of your Lord. That's number one. And point number two is that Rabb is someone who is taking care of a thing till he takes it to its perfection and completion. So you are taking care of a plant or a tree or a garden or a chick, yes, or a puppy or anything you have, or a horsey, yes, or your own kid, your own son and daughter, you are taking care of till you take it to its perfection and completion. That's what you are trying. That's what you are trying. And that's why you are taking care of the nutrition of your kids, the dress of your kids, the shoes of your kids, the school of your kids, the ibadah of your kids, the Quran recitation of your kids. You take care or not? Yes. Till he gets graduate. Till he gets graduate. That's a type of perfection. So that what you are doing, and that what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing regarding every single thing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whatever you are reading, whatever you are reading, do it with the intention of tarbiyah, that I will do it for the good of the creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you became a doctor, yes, but your intention is to serve the creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the best of my knowledge, not only for the sake of dollars, not only for the sake of, then you will be doing your own profession and you will be getting reward as well. You will be getting reward as well. You are an engineer and you will say, I will do it professionally. Yes, so I may not harm anybody because of my work. Got it? So that what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put the condition of Rabbika. Iqra, read bismi Rabbika, in the name of your Lord, allazi, that Lord khalaq, who created. Iqra, read bismi Rabbika, in the name of your Lord, allazi, that Lord khalaq, who created. Who created what? So once again, he did not mention the object. He did not mention the object to generalize that creation. That allazi khalaqa al-khalaiqa kullaha, that one who created the whole world. Who created the whole world? Iqra bismi rabbika allazi, read in the name of your Lord. Read whatever you can read, but with one condition, permissible. Bismi rabbika, in the name of your Lord, the second condition, that you must do it with the intention of tarbiyah. Allazi, that Allah khalaqa, who created what? The whole world. He created what? The whole world. Khalaq al-insana, he created the human being, min ghalaq, from ghalaq. So now, in the whole world, human being is also included. It is or not? Because it is part of the world. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, specifically he mentioned him. That's called takhsis barat tamim. Specification after generalization. After that, he generalized the concept. Now he specified that khalaqal insana, he created human min khalaq, from cloth. So every animal is created from cloth. That is, yes, the birth procedure is like this, that every animal is created of what? Cloth. So it means that human basically is animal. Human being is basically animal. Allazi khalaqal insana, who created human min ghalaqin, from clot. Iqra, read. Repetition of iqra, read, means the importance of knowledge and reading in Islam. Yes, in three verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repeatedly mentioned iqra, iqra, read. Iqra, read, wa rabbuka al-akramu, and your Lord is al-akramu. Akram is from karam, and karam has two meanings in Arabic language. Number one, honor and respect. And number two, generosity. So it means that iqra, read, wa rabbuka al-akramu, and your Lord is al-akramu. He is the most generous. He is the most generous. So he will give you the knowledge, but you should read. That's not a CD that somebody will fix in your brain and then you will have all the knowledge. No, you have to make your own efforts. Allah is very generous in this regard. He will give you the knowledge of the subject concerned, but you should make your effort. Got it? Got it or not it? Yes, that's one meaning. Another meaning. وَرَبُّكَ الْأَكْرَمُ, your Lord is most generous. So people are getting money from the generosity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the knowledge there.
Tara wa rabbukal akram allazi that Allah al akram,
who is the generous. So it has furthermore interpretation. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin wa salatu wa salam ala rasuli Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Allah